द कंप्लीट वर्क्स ऑफ स्वामी विवेकानंदा भक्ति पार्ट वन इन रिस्पॉन्स टू इन्विटेशंस फ्रॉम पंजाब एंड कश्मीर स्वामी विवेकानंदा ट्रेवल थ्रू दोज पार्ट्स ही स्टेड इन कश्मीर फॉर अ मंथ एंड हिज वर्क वॉज वेरी मच एप्रिशिएटेड बाय द महाराजा एंड हिज ब्रदर्स ही देन स्पेंट अ फ्यू डेज इन विजिटिंग मुरै रावलपिंडी एंड जम्मू And at each of these places, he delivered lectures. Subsequently, he visited Sialkot and lectured twice, once in English and once in Hindi. The subject of the Swamiji's Hindi lecture was Bhakti, a summary of which, translated into English, is as follows. The various religions that exist in the world, although they differ in form of worship, they are really one. In some places, the people build temples and worship in them. In some, they worship fire. In others, they prostrate themselves before idols. While there may be many who do not believe at all in God, all are true. For if you look to the real spirit, the real religion and the truths in each of them, they are all alike. In some religions, God is not worshipped. Nay, his existence is not believed in. But good and worthy men are worshipped as if they were gods. The example worthy of citation in this case is Buddhism. Bhakti is everywhere, whether directed to God or to noble persons. Upasana in the form of bhakti is everywhere, supreme, and bhakti is more easily attained through jnana. The latter requires favorable circumstances and strenuous practice. Yoga cannot be properly practiced unless a man is physically very healthy and free from all worldly attachments. But bhakti can be more easily attained and practiced by persons in every condition of life. Chandiliya Rishi, who wrote about bhakti, says the extreme love for God is bhakti. Prahlad speaks to the same effect. If a man does not get food one day, he is troubled. If his son dies, how agonizing it is to him. The true bhakta feels the same pangs in his heart when he yearns after God. The great quality of bhakti is that it cleanses the mind and firmly establishes bhakti for the Supreme Lord, which alone is sufficient to purify the mind. O God, thy names are innumerable, but in every name thy power is manifest, and every name is pregnant with deep and mighty significance. We should think of God always and not consider time and place for doing so. The different names under which God is worshipped are apparently different. One thinks that his method of worshipping God is most efficacious, and another thinks that his is the more potent process of attaining salvation. But look at the true basis of all, and it is one. The Shaivas call Shiva the most powerful. The Vaishnavas hold to their all-powerful Vishnu. The worshippers of Devi will not yield to any in their idea that their Devi is the most omnipotent power in the universe. Leave inimical thoughts aside. If you want to have permanent bhakti, hatred is a thing which greatly impedes the course of bhakti. And the man who hates none reaches God. Even then, the devotion for one's own ideal is necessary. Hanuman says, Vishnu and Rama, I know, are one and the same, but after all, the lotus-eyed Rama is my best treasure. The peculiar tendencies with which a person is born must remain with him. That is the chief reason why the world cannot be of one religion. And God forbid there should be one religion only. For the world would be a chaos and not a cosmos. A man must follow tendencies peculiar to himself, and if he gets a teacher to help him to advance along with his own lines, he will progress. He should let a person go the way he intends to go, but if we try to force him into another path, he will lose what he has already attained and will become worthless. As the face of one person does not resemble that of another, so also the nature of one differs from that of another. And why should he not allow to be act accordingly? The river flows in a certain direction, and if you direct the course into a regular channel, the current becomes more rapid and the force is increased. But try to divert it from its proper course, and you will see the result. The volume as well as the force will be lessened. This life is very important, and it therefore ought to be guided in the way one's tendency prompts him. In India, there was no enmity, and every religion was left unmolested. So religion has lived. It ought to be remembered that quarrels above religion arise from thinking that one alone has the truth, and whosoever does not believe as one does is a fool, while another thinks that the other is a hypocrite, for if he were none, not one, he would follow him. If God wished that people should follow one religion, why should so many religions have sprung up? Methods have been vainly tried to force one religion upon everyone. Even the sword was lifted to make people follow one religion. History tells us that 10 religions sprang up in its place. One religion cannot suit all. Man is the product of two forces, action and reaction, which make him think. If such forces did not exercise a man's mind, he would be incapable of thinking. Man is a creature who thinks. Manushya, or man, is a being with manas, mind. And as such, as soon as his thinking power goes, he becomes no better than an animal. Who would like such a man? God forbid that any such state should come upon people of India. Variety in unity is necessary to keep man as man. Variety ought to be preserved in everything. For so long as there is variety, the world will exist. Of course, variety does not merely exist, and it does not merely mean that one is small and the other is great. But if all play their parts equally well in their respective position in life, the variety is still preserved. In every religion, there may have been men good and able, thus making the religion to which they belong worthy of respect. And as there are such people in every religion, there ought to be no hatred for any sect whatsoever.